Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have no apologies this morning, and our business today is our final stage one evidence session on the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. So welcome to the meeting Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Kevin Lee and Stephen Bunch of the Police Division at the Scottish Government, and Caroline Kabula, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. So welcome to you all, and thank you for agreeing to provide evidence to the committee today. So I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this evidence session. So can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks? Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to committee this morning about the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Bill. This bill embeds ethics into the legislative framework to ensure human rights are front and centre of policing in Scotland. It paves the way to reforming how police conduct is dealt with and enhances the independent scrutiny of policing. The bill draws on evidence led by former Lord Advocate Dame Elise Angelini, who undertook an independent review of police complaints, investigation and misconduct issues. Dame Elise heard from many individuals from different organisations and members of the public, as well as numerous focus groups. In 2022, a 12-week public consultation was held, which demonstrated broad support for the legislative changes recommended by Dame Elise Angelini. The measures in the bill build on the non-legislative improvements already made by policing partners. Importantly, the bill has been shaped by those who have had lived experience of the police complaint system, many of whom felt that the whole system was against them, that they became the victim and that there was no independent body to turn to. In seeking to raise and embed ethical standards, the bill places a statutory obligation on the Chief Constable to prepare, regularly review and disseminate the Code of Ethics reflecting its significance. Those who hold the office of Constable and the powers of that office have a higher duty than others to account for their actions and record what they did or saw in the execution of their duties. Therefore, an explicit duty of candour on individuals, constables and on the organisation of Police Scotland as a whole is introduced. To enhance independent scrutiny and remove any perception of familiarity in relation to misconduct proceedings, the bill amends regulation making powers to allow transfer of certain functions from the Scottish Police Authority to the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner. It provides the legislation governing disciplinary procedures can be amended to apply to former constables in particularly serious cases and provides for the consequences of gross misconduct by the application of advisory and barred lists to ensure those constables who do not meet the standards required of the police service are prevented from being able to work in policing. To avoid the police investigating someone they have a connection with or might even have worked with, PIRC will have the ability to investigate offences where it is suspected that it was committed by a person who formerly served with the police. If officers and staff experience poor service in a personal capacity, the bill clarifies that their complaint to Police Scotland will be able to be reviewed by the PIRC, which gives constables and staff an external body to go to. To strengthen the role of the PIRC in regards to any recommendation it makes to Police Scotland on their handling of individual complaints, there is a requirement that the outcome of those reviews are published and the Chief Constable must respond. The bill provides the PIRC with a power to take over consideration of complaints being dealt with by the Chief Constable or Scottish Police Authority, to improve the transparency of processes around how public interest matters are investigated. PIRC will have the duty to audit the arrangements for investigating whistleblowing complaints. This will encourage people to speak up when they see wrongdoing. The PIRC has also given new functions to investigate serious incidents or criminal offending involving constables from forces outside Scotland which occur in Scotland. to support Police Scotland to improve, the PIRC will have a new power to review a policy or practice of the authority or Police Scotland where the PIRC considers that it would be in the public interest. To improve efficiency, transparency, independence and public confidence in the police complaints process, the bill paves the way for PIRC to have direct access to audit and review files in Police Scotland's complaint database independently and remotely. And finally, to strengthen PIRC's decision-making, the bill puts in place a statutory advisory board to advise the PIRC on governance and administrative matters. Convener, I want to ensure that the public have confidence in the police complaints and misconduct system, and I'm committed to working with members, policing partners and, importantly, people with lived experience to ensure that this legislation achieves its aims. So thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. It's a helpful opening, setting the scene. So I wonder if I can kick things off with a question, and as you say, the Scottish Government's aspiration for this legislation is to ensure that there are robust, clear and transparent mechanisms in place for investigating complaints and allegations of misconduct. So during our evidence sessions, the issue around culture has come up, and witnesses have told us that for them to have real confidence in the police complaints system, the culture within Police Scotland must change. So it's clear that there has been a lot of work going on within policing to implement the non-legislative recommendations in Lady Eilish Angelini's review since her review was completed. And that was particularly highlighted last week by the HMICS, who reflected on his recent inspection on organisational culture. And he said, and I quote, there was a real gap in the provision of leadership training and cultural change during the first 5 or 6 years, meaning of Police Scotland's existence. And it is a very different organisation to the one that we see today. I see that as positive. So I'm just wondering, on the issue of culture, just from your perspective and in the context of the bill, what the bill is seeking to do, do you feel that we are starting to see the necessary culture change within Police Scotland?
I do, Convener, and the point that you make in your question about the importance of culture, and of course the HMICS has done a significant amount of work around scrutinising, making recommendations, how to embed good organisational structure is very important. And I would never pretend that legislation alone is the silver bullet or the entire answer. But what the Scottish Government has sought to achieve here is, in response to our overwhelmingly positive response to the independent Dame Eilish Angelini review, where the vast majority of those recommendations were accepted, around two-thirds of those recommendations were non-statutory. 58 of those recommendations have already been implemented. In terms of oversight of that work, there is a ministerial group that is chaired by myself, and that's about giving ministers assurance that policing partners are implementing recommendations, and particularly those non-legislative recommendations. And that work was also supported with a strategic oversight group as well as a practitioners group. So it's important to stress, and I hope I managed to do this in my opening remarks, that we, you know, having, you know, regularly informed Parliament through, you know, GIQs, we've written to committee a number of times in terms of the thematic reviews, because you can group Dame Eilish's recommendations, you know, into, you know, training in HR, you know, effectiveness and efficiency. And there are many, you know, kind of, you know, well-organised themes of her work and a recommendation which has assisted in the policing partners' reporting of that, and particularly in the correspondence that was sent to this committee over a number of years now. But Now we have to, you know, move forward, build on the change that has begun, and, you know, deliver on those, you know, commitments that we made to introduce legislation on the minority of Dame Alicia's recommendations that required statutory provision, you know, whether that's in and around the Code of Ethics, duty of candour, strengthening the independence and the role, and broadening the role of the PIRC.
Thank you for that. I wonder if I can just add ask another question, and it's more to do with the actual complaints process. And it relates to, against the evidence that we've heard from a number of witnesses who have, you know, who feel that the provisions in the bill as they're set out are fine in themselves. But what they would like to see is a more radical overhaul of this complaints process so that it is as independent as possible. So I just wondered if you think the bill goes far enough to meet those aspirations, particularly of members of the public and former officers who've had experience of the complaints system themselves, but who feel and indicated that an independent process would perhaps be a more sort of transparent and effective one.
Well, of course, the processes are independent, and you know, nonetheless, I do very much understand where many of the witnesses that have given evidence to this committee, you know, the position that they have come from, and, you know, how they have felt, you know, disenfranchised from a system, and that the historical system has, you know, they have not been you know, treated well, you know, in that and that process, and people are raising questions about fairness as well as effectiveness and efficiency. What I would point to in terms of the work that has already been delivered or is already in train, you know, prior to the introduction of this legislation, is, for example, work around transparency and accessibility. There were 8 recommendations made by the Angelini Review around improving transparency and accessibility, whether that's, you know, publicising, you know, the right to complain, the recourse beyond PIRC to the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman, greater public sharing of work of the SPA's Complaints and Conduct Committee, for example. There were other recommendations that were very focused on training and human resources, you know, whether that's, you know, mediation and customer handling, training and support for frontline managers, the changes that have taken place in the police standards department, which are much more focused on early engagement and early resolution, and the work of Police Scotland around frontline resolution as well. You know, all of that is particularly important. And I suppose what has evolved with the PIRC over a number of years is they have adopted their recruiting practices. So when it was established under the 2013 Act, there was certainly a preponderance to recruit you know, previous or former police officers, bearing in mind their skills and experience in investigation. However, recruitment policies have now changed, because there's an acceptance that you need that broader diversity of people coming into an organisation, and that policing isn't the only organisation where people develop experience and skills and investigation. So there's a number of changes that have taken place in terms of Police Scotland, both in terms of the Professional Standards Department. There's also changes, you know, that PIRC has made in and around its governance as well, you know, in response to the interim review by Angelini as well.
thank you. And just on that point that you made there about, I suppose, the inclusion of former officers within the sort of perk, that was something, again, that the HMICS picked up on last week and did highlight that balance between independence, but obviously having staff within PERC having that sort of skill set to run complex investigations involving things such as mobile telephony and data. So, yes, it does seem to be about getting that balance. So thank you for that. So I'm going to open up questions now, and I'm going to bring in Sharon Dowie, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Good morning. Section 15 of the bill gives PERC the power to review practices and policies of the police generally, and not just in relation to a particular incident. So while PERC supports this, HMICS does not. However, last week when we heard from Craig Naylor, he said that in the 2 years that he's been in role, PERC has not passed a single policy or procedure of Police Scotland to HMICS to review it. Do you think this power is necessary for the PERC? Because they mentioned whether it was blood and responsibilities.
So I do think it's very important that we are alert to any risks of duplication, because duplication of functions leads to, you know, confusion or inefficiency. I was heartened by the contribution of Michelle McLeod, who, you know, she spoke to that commitment of PERC to work, you know, closely with HMICS. But picking up on the point that you raised, Ms Dowie, I'm aware that Mr Naylor had raised the prospect of perhaps this bill being amended to enable, give PERC the power to refer particular matters to HMICS, you know, where that is appropriate. That is something that I will give, I can assure you, all due consideration to. I suppose in broad terms, HMICS, you know, provide that close scrutiny and commentary and recommendations around whether the policy and procedures are appropriate, whether, you know, they're in the right domain, and whereas PERC is often more about the application of existing policies and procedures. But I do think, you know, PERC are well placed to, you know, based on the recommendations that they can make to policing partners, I mean, I think they are well placed to also be highlighting any gaps and measures, and well placed to be, you know, producing and informing partners of any vital learning as well.
So are you surprised that PERC haven't actually sent any policies to HMICS to review?
I'm not sure I've got an opinion either way specifically on that, but I am alert to the evidence that this committee has heard that perhaps there needs to be, you know, the explicit power to do that when appropriate.
I think it's just probably in the evidence that we've received, it's one of the things that's been highlighted quite a lot. So it does, and I'll come on to that in a wee minute, but it does look as if it's something that needs to be looked at in great detail. HMICS can also be directed by Scottish ministers to undertake research or inspection activity in relation to any aspect of policing in Scotland. Have you directed HMICS to look at any of the aspects of police regulations, conduct procedures? Or?
No, not in my time as Cabinet Secretary, no.
So have you, sorry, in your time as well, do you know of any direction that's been given to HMICS to look into any of the policies or procedures of Police Scotland?
I'm not aware of any, but I mean, I can ask officials if they, you know what the position factually is historically. I suppose my focus, I'll let officials kind of contemplate that. I mean, my focus in terms of improvement on matters in and around misconduct and complaints has been very much focused on this bill.
I think a lot of things that Police Scotland felt were holding them back were the fact that these regulations, a lot of them, were out of date. So I'm just wondering, because we've obviously heard it in our evidence, you obviously have regular meetings with everybody, so you'll have heard it as well. So I'm just wondering if AMD had been given an instruction to go in and look at their current policies, procedures, regulations and update them.
So what this bill does is that it enables existing regulations to be revisited in terms of the small number of enabling powers that it has. This is obviously an amending bill. So the legislation does give the opportunity for that to be done, particularly where there's the introduction of where secondary legislation is required. Mr. Will be aware, as other committee members will be aware, that police conduct regulations are all in secondary legislation and have been for, you know, many, many, many years. So the legislation at the appropriate parts gives an opportunity to revisit that. All of that is done in consultation with organisations such as the Scottish Police Consultative Forum. So the vehicle for this is this legislation, as opposed to me inadvertently stepping into operational matters for Police Scotland. And it's important to remember that Police Scotland is directly accountable to the Scottish Police Authority, and that's to do with the separation of powers and how the Police Fire and Reform 2012 Act is crafted to ensure that. Is there anything that officials want to add at this point?
Yeah, I can come in there. Just to say that HMICS sets out a work plan for the inspections that they'll carry out, and that's online, and you can see that it's publicly available. I'm not aware that they've been directed by Scottish ministers in my capacity, but that's something we can look into and come back to the committee on.
Right. It just seems if it's an issue that's been highlighted quite a few times in my evidence, it would be something that ministers would maybe direct.
I suppose it's an argument for this bill.
But that's what I'm saying. I think a lot of that would fix some of the problems that we've had in the bill.
If bits of E to do it through the bill as opposed to direct from ministers. I think I would be right in saying that, Caroline.
Yeah. Okay. David Kennedy of the SPF told us that in England and Wales, a lot of Lady Eilish Angelini's recommendations are getting turned back. They're now reversing what she recommended because they've realised that a lot of it doesn't work. And a number of non-legislative recommendations have now been implemented. And from the evidence that we've heard, there does seem to be a lot of improvements. There seem to be a lot of positive comments when we got some of the evidence. So I was wondering, has anyone done a full review of the impact and benefits that are now in place, rather than pushing ahead with the legislative recommendations just now? And has anyone been in and reviewed the comments that he's made about England and Wales to see what the issues were there, to see whether it's actually still worth going ahead with some of the legislative?
So I suppose in broad terms, I mean, the purpose of this bill, it shouldn't be, you know, looked at in isolation. I hope I've made that clear in my remarks to the convener earlier, that the non-legislative work is of fundamental importance, but we need to complete the process with the statutory requirements, the statutory recommendations made by Lady Eilish. So I see both the legislation and the non-legislative recommendations as part of a bigger package. It is important, given that we all value that the principle of policing by consent, it is important that we, you know, continue to do everything to ensure that there are rigorous processes in place for dealing with issues of misconduct and gross misconduct. That's imperative to public confidence in policing. In terms of what's happening in England and Wales, I mean, I'll happily pick up on any specific issues you want to raise. But, I mean, of course, we look at south of the border in terms of other jurisdictions that are nearest to us. And the as you'd expect, you know, there is, you know, cross-border cooperation in day-to-day business, and also in terms of the issue that we may come on to in terms of the advisory and barred lists. There's a very important cross-border issue there too.
Okay, I'm still sticking with regulations here. So the Scottish Police Federation told us that the current performance regulations, which came in alongside the conduct regulations in 2014, have never been used. That was disputed by Police Scotland, but Deputy Chief Constable Spears said the conduct regulations were introduced in 2014. Now we're in 2024. They are not fit for purpose, and a number of gaps are restricting our progress, such as the inability to fast-track process, equity or parity of voice at conduct hearings, our inability to proceed without delay, as we have to wait for criminal proceedings to be completed, and with a few other things. When asked if we needed to get that on the bill now instead of having to wait for secondary legislation, he said that would be my ask of the committee. So
the difficulty with that is that conduct regulations right now are in secondary legislation, and the way to change conduct regulations is via secondary legislation. Now, that also means that any changes have to be, there needs to be extensive engagement on, and they need to be consulted on as well. So, and again, that's due to obligations placed upon us in the 2012 Act as well. So again, I see the way forward, or the vehicle for change, for the practicalities of what you've spoken about, Ms Dowie, as via the primary legislation, which enables to revisit secondary legislation. Do officials want to add anything? Is there any kind of finer point of detail, Caroline?
So the Act is actually needed to widen some of the enabling powers for the legislation. So the rest of it's being done in secondary legislation. We're not entirely sure the extent of what the Chief Constable was asking for here, but some of it seems to be beyond what might have been in Dame Eilish's original recommendations, and therefore they've not been consulted upon at all in any type or in any shape or form. And really, I think there would be a difficulty in us proceeding with trying to put 50 pages of conduct regulations amendments in the bill that have not been consulted on at all. And therefore, for that reason alone, it would be better to proceed with the secondary legislation process, because that has inherent in it a detailed consultation process.
Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, do you want to come back in there? Because I'm just going to move on to another member.
I suppose the only point I would add to that is what we do have to avoid is a piecemeal approach. So as a government, we made a commitment to bring forward primary legislation to cover the necessary legislative changes that are referenced in my opening remarks. But that also needs to be supported by secondary legislation where that is necessary. And we need to, in doing that, we need to avoid a piecemeal approach. So how matters are phased and sequenced is of particular importance. So how you bring together aspects of the work that's specifically in relation to conduct regulations will be important, because even although secondary legislation is required, flown from this bill, we need to move forward in a planned, phased manner, but not in a piecemeal way. I just wanted to add that to hopefully give some assurance to Ms Dowie.
If I can move on, I'll come back to you. Russell Finlay, then Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. One of the key Angelini recommendations was for PERC to be made answerable and accountable to Parliament. That's not in the bill. Could you explain your thinking about why this particular recommendation has been disregarded?
Yeah, so there's been a number of developments. So just for clarity, Convener, some of the recommendations from the Dame Eilish Angelini review were around having deputy commissioners and moving from a commissioner to a commission. And of course, the underlying raison d'etre, as I understand it, of these recommendations was to ensure accountability to Parliament. I suppose three points I would like to make. After some consideration, it became apparent that we couldn't establish a commission as well as accommodating two deputies. And the reason for that is about that clear line of accountability, so that if all commissioners share legal accountability, yet some commissioners, as in the deputy commissioners, are subservient to the primary commissioner. And I know this is, you know, a bit of a kind of wander into the detail, but I suppose a more simple point is that I'm aware that Dame Elish was very initially very inspired by the Irish model. However, with the passage of time, the Irish model is also now moving towards the commissioner model, as opposed to the other models.
Reason why you can't do it, or you're not opposed to the suggestion that the PERC should be answerable and accountable to Parliament?
So the final point I was going to make, I've kind of tried to, in the most basic way possible, talk through some of the technical issues. And if members want more information, officials can come in or we can follow up in writing. I would actually argue that via parliamentary attendance, whether that's Scottish ministers or indeed the commissioner, I mean, I would argue that PERC, you know, are accountable to Parliament. I mean, they are accountable to other organisations, you know, in terms of other, you know, functions that they have. But I would contend that they are, you know, that there is an accountability to Parliament.
Yeah, there may be, but this is a change in status that she called for in the legislation, and that's not happening.
It's not happening.
No,
it's not
okay.
Happening for reasons that I've outlined.
Okay. Now, the Finance Committee have raised concerns about the cost of the bill. It's projected to have risen from 1.4 million to 5.8, possibly higher. I've read the Finance Committee transcripts, and it seems like we're a bunch of softies compared to them in their exchanges with you recently. The Finance Committee conveners actually said that the Scottish Government provided their committee with, and I quote, figures that it knew were completely inaccurate. And he actually wrote to the presiding officer on the 16th of April to say that the Scottish Government knew for 6 months the figures were out of date but didn't tell them. It's quite a charge. I just wondered how you would respond to that and how we can now trust the new figure of 5.8 million.
Quite correct that there was a robust exchange of views between myself and the convener of the Finance Committee, all in the interest of transparency and scrutiny. My officials had a session with Finance Committee, and a few weeks later I also went and had that pleasure. What I have repeatedly stated verbally and in writing is that at the time of the bill's introduction, the financial memorandum was the best estimate of costs. Those costs have now been revised because of different information from Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Federation.
Was the government knew this for 6 months?
No.
And didn't tell them?
Well, so, and again, and if I haven't followed this up in writing with this committee, I'm happy to do so. But at, and this should be in the transcript of my attendance at Finance and Public Audit Committee, where I went through the timeline. So the bill was introduced June last year. My officials were told informally in the autumn that policing partners were doing some work to revise the costs, because the costs, now that they had seen the text of the bill, that they would need revised. The policing partners submitted their evidence, was published on the 8th of November last year, and my officials were aware of that on the 6th of November. And as I said to Finance Committee, I don't just accept what people tell me something is going to cost. I expect my officials to robustly examine that. And we, however, got to the point in earlier this year, March, where the government accepted those revised costs. So the financial memorandum was the best estimate based on the information that I and my officials had at the time.
Okay, thank you. A fairly general question. We've heard evidence about good police officers' careers being destroyed and innocent members of the public being treated like criminals. And often it's not the original failing that is perhaps the greatest issue. It's the subsequent process that they then experience. Often they experience cover-up, delays, disregard and weaponisation of process. And we've also heard quite a bit from senior policing figures in the past few weeks that they've been doing a great deal of work to change the culture. And I suppose my question is whether you're confident that the bill will protect good officers going forward and the public, or whether there's an issue about a fairly deeply ingrained culture within policing that the bill in itself cannot fix.
So the bill is about fairness of process and the independent aspects of those processes that, you know, require to be independent. And, you know, we have to be fair to all parties. I mean, as a parliament and a government, we've got obligations to uphold convention rights, which means that we have to be fair to people who are making a complaint, and also those people who the complaint is referenced about. In terms of your broader point about ingrained culture, Dame Alicia Angelini did, I think, accurately say that, you know, cultural changes, you know, don't happen overnight, and if they do, they won't be sustained. So, you know, this is, you know, a journey that we need to be committed to, you know, for now, you know, and for the longer term. Do I think culture is changing? Yes, I do. And that is in part because of the work that Police Scotland does around diversity, inclusion, how it is moving forward as an organisation that actively tackles racism, misogyny, and also in terms of the monitoring and accountability and the auditing processes that have been improved both within the PIRC, both within Police Scotland and within the Scottish Police Association. I think we have now have a much more robust packages, but we do need to continue that journey, and this legislation is part of that.
Told us that they would like the bill to include a provision whereby Chief Constable would be able to sack officers following due process, and they say that they've been in discussion with the Bill's team for over a year. Is that now going to be included in the bill?
I'm certainly considering it. Right. Certainly considering it, and we'll do some further work over the summer in that regards.
Okay. Now, PIRC, we've got a strange situation where the bill is attempting to give PIRC new powers, but PIRC have told us either they're not able to do these for financial reasons, or they don't want them. They've actually said, in respect of the Bill's Section 5, that further detail is critical. That's their exact quote. And they actually strenuously oppose being given some of the, one particular function, which is the holding of senior officer gross misconduct cases. They say they don't have the skills or the resources to do so. There would be a lack of oversight of them and it would even impact on their ability to operate. Have you listened to those concerns, and are you doing anything to address them in respect of the legislation?
Of course, I met with the Commissioner just last week. It's not my first engagement with the Commissioner. I do engage regularly with all policing partners, and I do, you know, obviously note and pay attention to, you know, where there are differences of opinion from Park Police in Scotland, HMICS, Scottish Police Federation. I mean, people are, well,
changes.
So people are when we get into the detail of a bill, you know, not everybody all the time is facing in the same direction. And then the government has to come to a view, and ultimately Parliament has to come to a view.
Sure.
So, there are some aspects that we might come on to later in terms of whether the Commissioner should be on the prescribed persons list. I think there are practical arguments that the Commissioner is deploying, in my view, effectively. But in a more global sense, while this bill in many instances either clarifies the role of the PIRC or extends, you know, an existing role, you know, maybe takes some roles or duties that are narrowed and broadens them out, I think it is important that particularly in those senior officer cases, that the role of PIRC is expanded and that those functions are transferred from the Scottish Police Authority to PIRC. And that is just for very pragmatic reasons, that we have one police force in Scotland, I suppose a comparatively small number of very senior police officers who will have a proximity to the Scottish Police Authority. So I think the role of PIRC as a credible partner in policing, the cornerstone of policing in terms of holding police to account on behalf of the public, is very important.
Correctly. PIRC, you're sympathetic to PIRC's view that they should not be designated as a prescribed organisation for the purpose of whistleblowers. They want to be a gateway rather than a particular recipient of whistleblower complaints.
Yeah,
But HMICS are taking a different view. They believe PIRC should have that power, and furthermore that power should be given to the SPA also, and that would make officers in Scotland have an option, I suppose, of going to PIRC or SPA. But it sounds like you're more minded to not go down the route of making PIRC the prescribed organisation.
Well, the legislation for that is actually reserved. We are, of course, in discussion with the UK government, but also the PIRC. So I think that was an example of where I think the Commissioner makes, in my opinion, a fair point. Parliament may have a different view. But what I am committed to is the transfer of functions from the SPA to the PIRC, because I think that is the prudent thing to do, given the perception of proximity between senior police officers and the Scottish Police Authority.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Runa Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask you about the duty of candour. The Scottish Police Authority has questioned whether the duty of candour will apply to a police officer who's off duty, and if so, to what extent? And do we think there needs to be a bit of clarity around that?
It does apply to off-duty officers.
I'm not sure there's any more clarity required in that. So it does. Thank you. That's great. And do you think that should also include staff, police staff, or should it just apply to police officers? Because the PIRC, Police Scotland and HMICS think it should apply to staff, but Unison oppose it.
Just tell me number three. Yeah, got it. So what we have to remember is that staff are employed on a different basis from police constables. So police staff are employed in the traditional manner, as most people in the world or in this country are. Whereas constables They're not employees, they are office holders, and they are office holders with very particular rights and responsibilities. And they are in a heightened position of trust. So the roles are quite distinct in terms of one is employed in the traditional sense and the other is a office holder who is safeguarded with particular responsibilities and duties. And again, in terms of that confidence in policing that the public have and how we continue to ensure that public confidence is high, I think that recognition of the heightened role and responsibilities of constables is important. There is, it doesn't mean that ethics are important to police staff, and there is a framework that applies to police staff as well in terms of ethics and values.
Okay, thank you. That clears it up. And one other question on a different subject is the matter of assessing allegations against former officers and within the 12-month time limit. I mean, is it for all former officers or just for senior officers that the PIRC can do this?
So if I've understood you correctly, you're asking about whether or not there is a 12-month limit for the PIRC to investigate or continue proceedings around people who are no longer serving senior officers. Yeah. So, and officials will correct me if I'm wrong, but that's not actually in the bill, but is an issue of practice and is something that guidance has been made public on that the PIRC have shared, is that I suppose there are times they need to make decisions in and around what's in the public interest in terms of pursuing matters, but that's at a very high level. I don't know if, Stephen, you want to add to that.
So Section 6 of the bill provides the power to allow misconduct procedures to be applied to former police officers, but that's for senior officers and for non-senior officers.
So senior officers only, not all?
And non-senior officers as well.
For
all officers.
Oh, right, OK, thank you.
In cases of gross misconduct.
In cases of gross misconduct.
Gross misconduct, yeah.
Okay, thank you. That clarifies that. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can just pick up on the provisions within the bill relating to calling in complaints. And that would be a function that the PIRC would have. And certainly in their evidence, the Scottish Police Authority, they expressed support for that particular provision. They felt that was a positive step forward. But I'm just really interested in maybe a little bit of the backdrop to that provision being in the bill.
So, I mean, in essence, Convener, this is about giving reassurance to public and also to police officers and staff that PIRC can conduct independent investigations into, you know, the most serious non-criminal cases of a complaint at any time, you know, if there's sufficient evidence that it's not been properly considered by Police Scotland. In terms of the call-in of relevant complaints, it's, in my view, important that can be done by PIRC's own volition, or, you know, they can consider the request of a complainer. So, you know, they're not having to wait to be asked.
Thank you. And as I say, the SPA were broadly supportive of it. And I think certainly from some of the other evidence that we heard, it does seem to be one of the provisions that would enhance the, I suppose, the investigation process. So thank you for that. I wonder if I can come to the provisions within the bill relating to the duty of candour on police officers. So the bill obviously places an individual duty of candour on officers only. Those staff would be covered by a separate organisational duty of candour achieved by amending the policing principles. I'm just wondering, should this individual duty also apply to all police staff, or at least to those with the same powers and responsibilities as police officers? So, for example, maybe custody staff who have a particular role. You know, they're not police officers, they are staff, but they are in a type of role where there is perhaps, you could say, there might be potential for there to be complaints made. So this is the view of the PERC Police Scotland and the HMICS, although it's opposed by by Unison. So I'm just interested in what your sort of response is to that.
So, I mean, I don't want to repeat myself, convener. I suppose that the core of this issue gets to the distinction of between being employed and being an office holder. Although I understand, you know, the logic of some of the arguments that have been marshalled in and around that some police staff have, you know, particular responsibilities in light of the examples that you have given. So I don't have anything further to add on our overall position, but I will check with Stephen.
Caroline.
Could also add that with the police officers, it's being added to their standards of professional behaviour because those have to sit in legislation. For staff, their code of conduct, that's part of their terms and conditions. It sits out of legislation of their terms and conditions of employment. So it is possible that perhaps some duties with regards to conduct could be added by SPA through the terms and conditions of staff, but that would have to be discussed further. And they would have to decide if they thought that was appropriate and fair and proportionate in the staff circumstances.
Yeah, thank you. And I suppose we're aware that over the years, more and more roles and responsibilities within Police Scotland that were once undertaken by officers are now undertaken by staff. So I suppose it's important that there is a recognition of that. Thank you for that. I don't know if Sharon Dowie, did you want to come in just on that point? Or I know that you had other questions and I'll bring you in just
there. Just a quick question in the last one.
Yeah, okay, that's fine.
Everyone find it now. So it was actually the bit, I'm still quite confused about what we need secondary legislation for and what can you just go into terms, conditions and for employment with the police. So is any of this bill needed to update and modernise the policy, procedures and regulations of Police Scotland, or can they do that out with this bill?
I would argue that this bill is needed.
So the bill's needed?
I would argue the bill's needed, otherwise I wouldn't be doing it.
So some of the things that we've actually heard for Police Scotland, but I went and asked last week, in the interest of everybody who wants a quick resolution to their problems, do we need to get that into the bill right now instead of having to wait for secondary legislation? And the answer was that would be my ask of the committee. So I'm just wondering, some of the things that I think would speed things up, not just for the victims, but also the people that are the allegations of the complaint, would be if we brought the secondary legislation in quicker. One of the examples was, I think he'd said about somebody that has now been suspended for 3 years. So is there anything in this bill that's actually going to speed up that process? Because I'm just wondering how much communication you would have with a victim who wants something done with a police officer who's still getting paid full pay, but it's taken 3 years, it's lost somewhere in the justice system. And I can't imagine that victim is going to be getting a regular phone call when it's taken 3 years to actually go and deal with it. So that's where they feel let down. But also public purse, we're talking about finances are not finite. So is there anything in this bill that's going to solve that?
So the point you make about the need for accelerated hearings, I think, is an important one. Now, you know, accelerated hearings aren't always possible or appropriate if you are committed to fair process and a process that's fair to all parties. And you're correct, Ms Dowie, that, you know, there can be a connection with criminal proceedings, and there's a whole, you know, programme of work around, you know, court efficiency and court catch up. So, you know, I accept the point about efficiency of proceedings, and of course that was, you know, subject to some of the non-legislative recommendations. But in terms of this bill, and I'll ask officials if they have anything to add, but to address some of the issues that we'd like to address via secondary legislation, the gateway to that is primary legislation. I mean, we have a situation where police conduct regulations are all currently and have been for years in secondary legislation. You've heard from Caroline earlier that, you know, that level of detail wouldn't go in the face of a bill. In terms of timescales, because I do think, you know, timescales are important. So, you know, if Parliament consents, you know, this bill will pass at the end of the year. It will get, you know, royal assent at the, you know, first quarter of next year. So the earliest that, you know, aspects of the bill can be implemented, you know, would be next summer. We will want to have a cohesive programme, particularly in and around, you know, conduct regulations, because I don't want to be, you know, pursuing matters that need addressed in a piecemeal fashion. I don't want to be, you know, coming to committee in dribs of drabs with, you know, single statutory instruments. So in terms of the overall delivery of the bill, where secondary legislation is required, we'll probably do it, you know, on three or four occasions and group things together where it makes sense, particularly in and around conduct.
I suppose that's why I was asking if any instructions would be given to HMICS to review any of this, because until we actually get this legislation through, if it's required for it, and it's going to take time to implement, is any work going on just now so that we're speeding up the process? Because speaking to the witnesses from Police Scotland, they can tell us just now what the problems are. In fact, one of the ones we actually heard from Craig Naylor last week, and he actually said that there was lengthy delays for victims who've made a criminal allegation. And he said it was a matter for the Lord Advocate. So again, are there discussions happening with the Lord Advocate as to, can we actually change some of these things that are wrong? And is the Lord Advocate looking at it so that somebody who has irrefutable evidence that they've got a dismissal, they will be dismissed from the role, is there something that she can look at just now to make sure that that person can get dismissed just now before we have to wait on the criminal proceedings?
I'm not sure whether the power that HMICS have recommended for the Chief Constable to have in certain circumstances, very high threshold circumstances in and around dismissal. I suppose that the policy of that wouldn't be for the Lord Advocate. But in terms of, you know, work that has been going on at pace, there's obviously the, you know, 58 non-legislative recommendations, you know, that have been implemented from Elise Angelini, and HMICS do substantial reviews. They've done one on vetting. We spoke earlier about the one on organisational culture. And primarily they make recommendations to police and partners, occasionally to government, and, you know, it is, for example, SPA to hold, you know, Police Scotland to account, and much of SPA's proceedings are done the public, and of course I engage with SPA, Police Scotland collectively and individually as well. Is there anything else you want to add,
yeah,
Kevin, just around maybe some specifics that would be useful for Ms Dowie?
Yeah, I mean, just, and obviously the comments that DCC Spears was making about the conduct regulations and how effective they are, I mean, we're just learning that pretty much at the same time as the committee, so that's a new development, I would say. As far as the conduct regulations go, however, myself, we have looked at those. Our reading is they don't prevent misconduct proceedings from continuing. The Deputy Chief Constable has a power, or it's at their discretion, to postpone proceedings while criminal proceedings are in play, but the conduct regulations don't stop it from happening. So from our point of view, that's something that we would intend to pick up with Police Scotland and the Crown Office to see what if there's something going on outside of the conduct regulations that's feeding to the scenario that was described to committee last week. But we were pretty clear that the conduct regulations are not getting in the way of proceedings continuing if the Deputy Chief considers it appropriate to do so. I don't know if Caroline would want to come in on that as well.
It's just correct everything that Kevin said, because all the conduct regulations do is give the Deputy Chief Constable who's dealing with the conduct process a power to suspend or postpone proceedings until the prosecutor says that the criminal proceedings will not be brought or that they've been completed. So it doesn't say that it has to happen, and we would need to investigate further as to if it is happening as a matter of course, what the reasons are before we could usefully assist here.
So I'm kind of the impression that once it goes to...
They're going to have to bring in other members. Pauline McNeill, then Fulton McGregor.
Good morning. There is quite a lot, I think, to get your hair down because of the mechanics of the different organisations. Well, I'm glad it's not just me. I've been trying to pursue some lines of questioning around what difference the public would see and trying to make it a bit real for myself, actually, and how this would make a difference on the ground. We had a helpful briefing from Victim Support Scotland today, which kind of sets out different categories of complaints, which I found really helpful, and a couple of examples. I just wanted to use one of the examples, because I think it's actually, when I read it, I thought, I remember the case. Anyway, so this is a case of a complaint which Victim Support Scotland supported against a police officer who had shared WhatsApp messages, including details of the injuries. And it was investigated by the Anti-Corruption Unit. And in fact, there were 13 officers referred, but there were no criminal proceedings in that case. So what I was thinking was, in fact, the officer concerned resigned. So in relation to the 12-month rule, and this is my question, would it be right in saying that there were no criminal proceedings, but the 12-month rule in a case like that would allow the pursuing of that officer or any other officer on the grounds of gross misconduct? I asked myself why it wasn't pursued on the grounds of gross misconduct in the first place. However, it was investigated by the Anti-Corruption Unit on the basis of criminal charges, but no proceedings. So it struck me that, well, the Police Scotland could then investigate that on the grounds of gross misconduct using the 12-month rule. Would that be right?
So that would be my understanding. Yeah.
Thank you. Now, I want to come to another point, which is about where the public have complained about. So there's a similar case where belongings weren't returned, or there was misconduct or an allegation of some kind, particularly into high profile. Criminal case. We're talking about victims and victims' families. Now, I don't think there are any time limits when the public complain and it goes to PERC. Am I right in saying there's no time limits for that? And the reason I think there isn't is because Victim Support Scotland said PERC should have stronger powers to insist within the statutes of the law that Police Scotland return responses within, it says, the time limit, so there might be time limits. So I know we've been discussing time limits in relation to the conduct of police officers, but I'm thinking here about when the public complain, because I'd have thought it's quite an important thing to address, given that one of the purposes of the bill is to give the public more confidence when they meet complaints.
Yeah. So there's no statutory time limits in the bill, and but I mean, I understand the point that Ms. McNeill makes, that it is one of efficiency, it's one of fairness, and it's also about how both the person that's been complained about and the complainer are treated as well. You know, across the justice system, we talk a lot about trauma-informed practice, and that's germane here. There is a number of strands of work that should improve timescales, you know, so, and that's work that, in terms of police complaints handling processes, by Police Scotland and also the PIRC. I'd mentioned earlier about the frontline resolution process, and that's about broadening the opportunities for early engagement and, where possible, early resolution. That has coincided with some structural changes within the Professional Standards Department as well. There is also the PIRC statutory guidance that was introduced in 2021, and there have been further improvements to both audit and review practices, whether that's within Police Scotland, PIRC and SPA, and that's just about that regular cycle of monitoring and understanding where people are in the resolution of complaints, and obviously to avoid things such as backlogs. But there's no statutory time limits.
Thank you very much. I believe that those who complain are not entitled to information regarding the outcome of a misconduct investigation.
Just now, mm-hmm. or via the bill?
Or does the bill help with that?
So the bill helps with that in terms of that if the PIRC is making recommendations to you know, Police Scotland or the SPA, that those recommendations you know, can be published, and where there are time limits is for the Chief Constable to give an initial response and also a progress update. I think an initial response to recommendation should be within 8 weeks, but that a kind of progress update can be given within 12 months.
So it is possible for families to be told of the outcome of a complaint, gross misconduct or a misconduct complaint?
As I understand it just now, Police Scotland have started publishing the outcomes of gross misconduct hearings, and I think that part of our plans is for secondary legislation to put that into statute.
Okay. Thank you. That's really helpful. In relation to the 12-month proposal in the bill, had you considered fairness for officers who've left and went on to other employment who might have been unaware? I've got a slight concern. I'm not concerned about officers who leave when they know there's a complaint. I'm concerned about officers who had no knowledge, being caught within the 12-month, and then following from that, they would have the right to defend themselves and appeal against it. So at the moment, my feeling is I'm not minded to support extensions of that limit, especially if then after that, if that 12 limit is where you up to you can pursue an officer, so it could last for much longer before the proceedings are then held, and then they can appeal that decision, unless I've misunderstood how that would work.
So the 12 month timescale, it's not in the bill, so it's not a hard and fast statutory requirement. It is one of judgment for the PIRC in terms of public interest and fairness, and it needs to be a rounded decision based on all the facts and circumstances Is there anything you'd like to add to that, Stephen?
Yeah, just that the bill allows former constables to be pursued, but it doesn't set that time period, as the Cabinet Secretary says.
So there's a kind of a bit of gatekeeping, if you like, on deciding which cases will be pursued. But it's not in the legislation that they can do this up to 12 months.
So there's a professional judgment.
So it could be longer than 12 months.
There's a professional judgment made by the park on the merits and details of the case and what's in the public interest.
Okay, and they would have to, do they have to take into account that if they go longer than that, that the officer themselves would need to get a form of representation? So they might not be covered by the Police Federation if they've left, for example.
Yeah,
are these things that should be considered?
Yeah, so the park are well aware of processes and people's rights and, you know, their right to defend themselves.
My last question in this kind of area, which Sharon Dowie had pursued, this is maybe another way of looking at it. So I've looked at some cases where, mainly cases where there's the allegation of assault, criminal matter, so can take quite a time to get into court. We know that, and those periods are getting shorter. But Police Scotland often does proceed against officers where there's been no criminal proceedings on the same facts. It just seems to be a bit of a waste of police resource if the court has decided that there's no guilt attached, there's no guilt. I could understand if there were civil proceedings for gross misconduct or misconduct, if there were other matters, if you follow me. But what I suppose my question is it your view, it shouldn't necessarily be automatic that Police Scotland would hold disciplinary proceedings where a not guilty verdict on the same facts were found?
But it's a different threshold.
But it's still the same facts.
Yeah, so what's a criminal matter has to be, you know, proven beyond, you know, it has to be proven. Yeah, so you can still. I'm thinking about.
That's what others have said, but I don't really understand that, because I could understand of the other matters other than the assault. But I mean, in other words, Police Scotland, in my view, shouldn't be conducting a mini civil trial on the same facts that was an assault committed if there was no other. But it just seems that to me that it shouldn't be automatic, because it could be construed as, well, they're not happy, they lost the case. I mean, it just seems odd that in all cases you would still proceed against police officers where they've been tried in a criminal court that could have taken 2 or 3 years to come to.
I suppose I'm actually thinking about any workplace here, although the context of what we are discussing today is police officers who have a higher threshold. So, but you can think of many scenarios in any workplace where, you know, the court has not proven beyond reasonable doubt that someone is, you know, guilty in a criminal offence, but they may still be guilty of a misconduct offence, which would be, you know, around the balance of probabilities. So it's not, you know, it's not that there's an automatic assumption or conclusion. It's just not unusual for criminal proceedings not to proceed, to come to an end, but thereafter there is a, you know, fair process, you know, in and around whether someone has committed a breach of conduct.
Just lastly, it's just about the duty of candour. So I've had a look at the current standards of professional behaviour, and there's a reference to honesty, integrity, authority, respect, equity, diversity, use of force, duties and responsibilities. I mean, it's maybe written in a different way, but it is quite strongly worded. And it could read as a similar duty of candour. Just what is your sort of take on that? Is it just a modernisation of it? I suppose the reason I'm asking that question is that obviously we would expect all police officers to cooperate and be honest, but a lot of police officers say, well, we are, and this is a regulation which we sign up to when we join. So what is the difference between that and a legislative duty of candour? Is it meaningful?
Yeah, so I suppose what the duty of candour does, and with it being rooted in legislation, is that it recognises what is already implied. Legislation, of course, makes it crystal clear. The expectations are crystal clear, you know, in and around that culture of cooperation, and it certainly raises the significance of duty of candour. And it was a very clear recommendation from the Angelini Review that the Office of Constables need to be held to a higher level of duty. And in terms of raising the significance of it by locating it in legislation, it certainly would allow case law in and around this area to grow as well.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Still got three members wanting to come in. We've got about 15 minutes or so left. So if I can ask for succinct questions and responses, and I'll bring in Fulton McGregor and then Katie Clark.
Thank you, convener. And I'll try and be as quick as possible. I've got a few questions. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to the officials. One of the questions I wanted to ask around was the bill. It does not address the Angelini Review recommendation around holding gross misconduct hearings in public. Now, we've heard mixed views on this, as we've taken some evidence, with some police organisations being completely opposed to that proposal and stating good reasons why they don't think that should happen. But other organisations, such as HMICS, for example, thinking that they should be held in public and citing other examples where that would be the case for other professions. What's your view on this? I know that you've said that you're not to bring it through this bill, but that you might introduce other legislation. Is that still the view of the government, or is there any change on that?
In terms of my view around gross misconduct hearings in public, I am not instinctively again. I think there are arguments for it. However, we will, you know, continue to engage with our policing partners who, as you've indicated, there is a range of views. We will, you know, take the opportunity we have with the time we have to, you know, look at, you know, the impact south of the border around public hearings as well. And in terms of, you know, as with any secondary legislation or other propositions, we have the opportunity to, you know, engage and consult further through the Scottish Police Consultative Forum as well. But I'm not instinctively going to, but still listen to the range of views.
Yeah, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Other area I want to ask about is the bill confers a duty on the SPA to establish and maintain police advisory and bard lists. Can I ask why the Scottish Government chose the SPA and not Police Scotland to establish and maintain the list, and is it the intention to publish the bard list? Because I think that both the Police Scotland and the SPA told us that they would rather it was maintained by Police Scotland themselves.
So these lists are important, particularly in terms of cross jurisdictions. To be candid, we need to bring Scotland in line with other partners in Great Britain. It is not acceptable for anyone who has been dismissed from Police Scotland to turn up and get a policing job elsewhere on these islands. Again, it was a recommendation from Dame Elish. Yes, in terms of that corporate kind of cross-jurisdiction responsibility. As things stand, we have put the administration of those lists onto SPA, although there is a power for the Scottish Police Authority to delegate it to, you know, for example, to Police Scotland. And it is important that lists within Scotland, you know, speak to lists that exist elsewhere on these islands, and also to include the non-territorial forces as well, whether that's, you know, British Transport, Police, Ministry of Defence, Police, or the Civil Nuclear Authority as well. And in terms of publishing, yes, it can be published, but I'll ask officials to just speak more to the nature of publishing and how that's achieved.
Yeah, I can come in on that there. So in England and Wales, the barred list is published, but the advisory list, where there's not an outcome reached, is not published. It's the police College of Policing in England and Wales that publish those lists, and the detail of these, the lists, will be set out in secondary legislation, but the bill itself just gives a power to create the list and puts that power on the Scottish Police Authority. Does that answer your question?
Yes, okay, thanks for that. And finally, Cabinet Secretary, I know that you'll be aware from watching the sessions and officials as well that I raised the case of a constituent last week who came to my surgery to detail their experience of the complaint system. I have to say again, just for clarity, that they consider the case now closed. They did sent them the video link to last week, and they reviewed the evidence. And I just wanted to highlight that they feel assured that things are moving forward and that changes have been made even from the time when they were going through the process. And I want to express their gratitude that they've given to me, to all committee members and the government and the clerks, that this issue has been looked at, because it had a very significant impact on her life and wellbeing. I just wanted to go through some of the further thoughts that they've shared with me in that correspondence. And there's probably not a need to respond to them all, Cabinet Secretary, because some of them have already been covered by other members. But they did make further comments on the PSD and having to sign heads of complaint, and been told if they didn't do that, that no further action could be taken. So that my constituent felt in a bit of a position around that, because they were also told by signing the heads of complaint that, that if anything criminal was suggested in there, the complainer's behaviour, the criminal action could be taken against them. So they do feel that something needs to be looked at in that part of the process. They've also spoke about not feeling that PIRC is particularly independent. The sergeant that dealt with their case constantly referenced knowing senior officers and who they knew within the case. So I know a lot of this has been covered. But probably the bit I would bring up to get some sort of response on was their final point when, in the last email to me, when they said that no frontline resolution was offered in their experience, no apology and a complete blanket response from PSD. So I guess what is there anything that can be done when cases are at an end? You know, there are closure that reflects the experience that complainers have had, whatever the outcome may be. Because I've said at the outset last week and today, I'm not going into the rights and wrongs of this particular case, because my constituent doesn't want me to do that. They want me to raise it in a general sense. But there must be a better way to bring things to closure that reflects the experiences that people have had, whether they are complainers or officers, or whether complainers are officers.
So, I mean, I would take the point about closure, and I think that's important for all parties, that irrespective of the outcome, that everybody has confidence in the process. And at its heart, this bill is about ensuring that our public have confidence in the processes that are set up to deal with the minority of cases where officers are involved in misconduct, but also more broadly in terms of that more welcoming and solution-focused approach to complaints resolution. I won't repeat what I've said earlier about the importance of the measures already in train in and around efficiency and effectiveness of processes, or you know, the work around timescales in terms of, you know, engaging more earlier, you know, seeking earlier resolution where appropriate. I'll ask officials to talk to the issue about heads of complaint. In terms of the PIRC, again, I won't repeat, convener, what I've said about the PIRC earlier in terms of their, you know, cornerstone role in the police and family in terms of holding policing to account. It might be of interest for Mr. Fulton's constituent to know that, you know, it's now the minority of PIRC staff who were, you know, former police officers. So 52%, you know, come from a non-policing background. And that speaks to that, you know, diversity of talents and skills and to the independence of the organisation. But I'll ask officials to talk to the heads of complaints issue. I don't know who wants to do that.
I can come in there. I think it'd be useful just to clarify exactly what the issue was. I think what I was jotting down there, the complainer signs the heads of complaint, and then if there's any criminal matters alleged in those heads of complaint, then that could have repercussions or something.
Yeah. Just let me get it up. I'll be able to tell you exactly what I was told.
I'm also, Mr. McGregor, I'm also happy to correspond with you, because I realise you're walking a tight rope here in terms of, you know, an individual case, but you're wanting to make some broader points that are of relevance to the legislative and non-legislative recommendations that have been implemented or are about to be implemented, and I'm happy to correspond with Mr. McGregor in detail about that.
I think that
would be helpful, and that would allow us a slower time, perhaps, follow-up correspondence.
Be good.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm going to bring in Katie Clark, and then I'm going to bring Russell Finlay back in very quickly.
Thank you very much. And if I could just pick up on this issue about lists and vetting, which, as you know, has been an absolutely massive issue in recent times. And obviously that's not necessarily something that might be dealt with in this legislation. But if you could provide an update on implementation on the inspectorate's recommendations. I mean, as you know, they have advised the committee that they think that the chief constable should be provided with the power of dismissal in cases where the person could not retain their vetting status. And indeed, Lady Angelina also advised that there should be the power of summary dismissal in some cases. So I just wondered, given the absolutely massive nature of some of the issues that have been coming forward recently, what consideration you've given as to whether the legislative framework around vetting is strong enough, and what more could be done to ensure a focus on this on an ongoing basis going forward, because I appreciate there may be one-off reviews, but we want this to be embedded, and I just wondered whether that's something that you're giving active consideration to.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and I'm pleased that committee, along with government, is very focused on the work of the HMICS in this regard, because it is vital if we want the public to continue to have confidence in policing, you know, to have robust vetting. Vetting is a key strand in providing that assurance. I, of course, as you'd expect, welcome the HMICS report into vetting. We are, in a more broader sense, committed to exploring the legislative basis for vetting, and I know that officials are talking to Police Scotland, SPA and HMICS in this regard. There are some very welcome additional checks for new recruits that Police Scotland introduced back in 2021. They've also massively increased their vetting resource by 50% since 2020. So the number of staff they have involved in this area has went up from 29 to 50. All of this work flowing from HMICS's report is underway within Police Scotland to address the recommendations. Obviously, SPA will hold them to regular account, and of course, their meetings are all in public. And I also take some comfort that Craig Naylor had said last October that Police Scotland vetting is very good, and HMICS think that the risks are diminishing every day.
Ongoing. More generally, in terms of this legislation and the models that the Scottish Government is going forward with, the committee has been told by one witness that an independent complaints process would be the gold standard. And witnesses have made it very clear that there needs to be public confidence in the complaints process, but also that the police can't police themselves. So I wonder, first of all, what your view is on the role of Police Scotland's Professional Standards Department continuing to internally assess and categorise and then investigate complaints, but more generally, whether you think there is scope for more independence in the system that we have in Scotland, and what your considerations have been around this.
So, firstly, I consider the PERC to be an independent, robust organisation. In terms of this bill, there are a range of measures. I won't go through them all, convener. I won't test your patience, but I refer to them in my opening remarks that, you know, broaden or strengthen or clarify the role of PERC. In terms of the PSD, it is entirely proportionate and reasonable for any, you know, frontline operational organisation, for where appropriate to be the first port of call to deal with complaints and issues. There are obviously ways in which matters can be escalated. There are a number of changes that have been made by Professional Standards Department that I referred to earlier, in terms of, you know, earlier engagement and earlier resolution where appropriate, but also the creation of the National Complaints and Resolution Unit also facilitates that requirement for all frontline resolutions processes to be dealt with by the Professional Standards Department as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. And a very final question from Russell Finlay.
Thank you. It's just to go back to the issue of duty of candour, which the bill would require all officers to adhere to, but would also apply to the 6,000 or so civilian staff. Unison have been quite explicit, saying that if that were the case, they would immediately seek a pay rise for every single one of their members. So I just wonder whether you're going to pursue that in respect of the non-police officer staff, and also how much it's going to potentially cost, if that's been factored into the 5.8 million.
So I've already, I think, I hope, addressed earlier, Mr. Finlay, that police staff are employed and not office holders. So that in terms of the duties upon them are very different from that of constables. They are, however, subject to a competency and values framework that Police Scotland have, and that supports all professionals and, you know, places, you know, the code of ethics into the core of that framework. And as with regards to matters of pay, that's just a separate process that commences on an annual basis.
So there's no plan to change direction. The bill will apply, the duty of candour will apply to civilian staff. It's not going to be changed.
So So where there's an organisational duty, it applies to everybody collectively.
But does it not worry you what Unison have said?
Sorry?
Does it not slightly concern you that what Unison are saying is if that does apply, then all those civilian staff, 6,000 of them, will be a regulated workforce in the same way as a police officer and won't expect.
But they're not regulated the same way as a police officer. I think that was the point I was trying to make.
So the Unison's position is perhaps misunderstood the legislation.
I'm happy to discuss and engage matters with Unison. In fact, I think I'm due to meet them soon.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that just brings us slightly over time. Thank you very much indeed to the Cabinet Secretary and officials for attending this morning. That's been most helpful. And with that, we'll now move into private session. Thank you.